Okay, good evening, everyone. I want to bring the message tonight with you, Lord's willing, on John chapter number 8 and verses 1 down through verse 11 and 12 there. This is the story of the woman that was caught in the very act of adultery, and she was brought to Jesus and asked the question, what should we do with her? The law of Moses says that she should be stoned. Now, this is a verse, a portion of scripture, that if you do not understand where you're at in the Bible and why you're there and what's happening at the very moment, you're going to misunderstand, or you're going to think that Jesus has a double standard, because the Bible does say that a person that's caught in a very act of adultery was to be stoned. But let's hear the story out. Let's hear it in contents of when Christ was here. And let's hear the whole thing out. And I'm not going to skirt around it about sin, of what sin is. That is sin. We're not going to skirt around it. We're going to teach the Word of God. So with this in mind, of this story, and I'm excited about telling this story. I'm excited about what the Lord has showed me and helped me with. So let's go ahead and read these scriptures. We're going to read all the way down to verse 11, I believe it is, and then we will take verse by verse and dissect it. So thank you for listening. Thank you for being with us. Okay, let's get started. John chapter number 8 and verses 1. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came up again into the temple. And all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commands us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? This said they, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger wrote on the ground, as he heard them not. And when they had continued asking him, excuse me, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest and even to the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. So we see these verses here, these first 11 verses here, and this is a story that I have heard people justify. I have heard people use it as the Bible's contradictory. The Bible is not fair in one situation, we're fair of another. I have shared with you many times, when we misunderstand something that is clear from the Word of God, either we have not the knowledge that we need to understand the background, the knowledge, or what the reason for the purpose, or simply we're just not rightly dividing the word of truth in the dispensation of time that we're in. So we're going to do that, and we're going to let the word of God speak for itself on why Jesus said, I condemn thee not, go and sin no more. Okay, so let's go ahead and get into this. And this is a positive message now, by the way. Please don't think this is something other than that. No, no. Let the word of God speak for itself, and the word of God will. Okay? Let's look at verse 1. It says, Jesus went out to the Mount of Olives. He did this often. And early in the morning, he came into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. Now, we see that verse 3 and 4, that they bring a woman caught in adultery in the midst and sets her in the midst. She is a spectacle. Now, listen, they were not trying to want justice. They wanted to trap the Son of God. And it even says this here, that they were tempting him. Now, I got a question. Let's go back into verse 2. It says, he sat down and taught them. Wonder what Jesus was teaching them in the midst, because he knew what was going on. He knew their hearts. He's God. He knows. I wonder what he was saying to them before they set her in the midst and asked, what should we do? Moses says to stone her. Let's think about what Jesus was teaching them. Now, first of all, you go back to John the Baptist. He's already announced the Messiah is here. That was the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Isaiah, other places, the Messiah will be here. All of those things, Christmas time, when Jesus was born, all of that. And the Bible says that John the Baptist said, this is the Son of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Now, why did Christ come? Well, he come to fulfill the law and not to destroy the law. Okay, we see that in 1 John 1:17. Moses came the law, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Maybe he was teaching them that it was time that the Father sent the Son, because they could not keep the law of the Old Testament. Old Testament was a picture of them trying to keep the law that they could not keep. It was a shadow of the things to come until Christ would come. So maybe Jesus was teaching them. It says in verse 2, he taught them. Maybe he was teaching them what Galatians 4:4 says. Maybe not in exact wording there, but it says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law. That is, to give grace. And so maybe Jesus was already teaching them, look, the law has done its job. The law condemns. The law points a person to the law and shows him that they're guilty. Maybe he quoted John 3:16 for them. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, that is under the Mosaic law, because we cannot keep it, but have everlasting life. Now let me go ahead and say this right here. Nothing wrong with the law. The law is right. The law was added to increase the knowledge of sin, to increase sin itself, to point us to the Messiah, the one that was going to come. So Jesus may have already been sharing with them these things as he taught them on a weekly basis. I am the Messiah. The Father has sent me. I am come, and I am fulfilling the law, and I am here to save and not to condemn. Now someone says, well, why didn't he condemn? We're already condemned. The law has already been put in place some 1900 years or so. They had the law, could not keep the law. He was saying, I am not come to destroy the law. I am come to fulfill it, which you cannot do. And so maybe he was already teaching these things to them. We're not certain what he was teaching, but we know that he offered the kingdom to them. He said, I am the Messiah. And if they would have accepted him as Messiah, and so maybe he was teaching them that, I believe along those lines. That's what John was saying. Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world, is here. And so we see in verses 3 and 4, let's go ahead and go down. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, see, they made her a spectacle. They done this on purpose. Now, God's purpose is not to humiliate people. His purpose is not to humiliate and to try to say that they're a bigger sinner than anyone else. No one's a bigger sinner than no one else. Everyone has sinned. James 2:10 says, if you keep the law and you fail in one area, you've broken them all. There's no big sinners and little sinners in God's eyes. Man does that. They set her in the midst, and they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery, in the very act. So now we know that the man was there that was with the woman in committing an adultery. Now we know that that has to be, too, okay, to commit adultery. Now, let me go ahead and read a verse over here that's going to expose to you and I what their motivation was. In Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 13, it says this, if a man lie with mankind, as he lieth with a woman, both of them shall be have committed abomination, and they shall be put to death. Okay? In another place in the same book, the man and the woman was to be put to death, both of them. Now, she was taken in the very act. They know the man that was there. Why didn't they bring both of them and cast them in the midst? Therefore, it would have been correct according to the word of God, but they didn't do that. See, they wanted to accuse Jesus. And that's what people that's got trickery in their mind or deception, they just don't think about these things, do they? But God's word's already thought about it, and God reveals it to us as we study the word of God. So they take her in the very act, and they bring her here, and they cast her in the midst, and they said, verse 5, now Moses in the law commanded us that she should be stoned. But what sayest thou? I like questions. Jesus Christ, you'll always see him asking questions. Even at the end, he asked the woman, where are thy accusers? You'll get answers, questions answered if you let people talk and ask questions. They asked a question, what sayest thou? The Son of Man has already made it clear that he did not come to seek and he did not come to destroy man's lives, but to save them. That was the purpose of him coming. Let me go ahead and go over to a verse in the New Testament. In Galatians chapter number 3, we're going to look at this. Let's go this together. Chapter 3. I believe it's verse 10 we want to start with. Okay, let me go on down through here. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident the just shall live by faith, okay? And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Listen to verse 13. Here's the key right here. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law. Now, at that very moment, the law, Mosaic law, was in place. But Christ had already presented himself as the King of the Kings, as the King of the Jews. He'd already said, receive me. He's already preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it says, he being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is he that hangeth on a tree. Jesus Christ, in the mind of God, in the fullness of time, God sent forth His Son. Jesus was there to offer peace. He, that is, pardon. He was going to pardon their sins, and already in the mind of God and Christ, as if it was already there. They were being offered the kingdom. They was rejecting the king as they stood there and accused him and tried to trap him. Now, I want you to notice in verse number six, and they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. Got a question for you. What do you think Jesus wrote? Now, if someone had the answers to that, well, first of all, it would be written in the Bible. So no one has the answers to that. But listen, we're going to be very logical here. And we're going to go for some scriptures that show you what he wrote on the ground. You ever thought about what Jesus wrote on the ground? Some says, well, he wrote Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 13. Or Leviticus 19, I believe it's verse 2 or 3 or 19 or 30 or somewhere. Of the woman and the man being brought and both of them being stoned. Okay, maybe he wrote those things. But remember, Jesus come to save. But a man or a woman has to be under conviction of sin before they will ever see themselves. We're going to see that Jesus is going to say, ye that are without sin, first cast the stone at her. So what does he do? I love Jesus when he does this. He always does this. And remember, Jesus is not trying to badger someone, but he is showing that God's holy and we are sinful. And the Bible goes on to say in chapter 19 of Psalms 19, it says this right here, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. What do you think Jesus wrote on that? I think he wrote the Ten Commandments on there. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make any graven image. Thou shalt not bear false witness, which they were doing at the very moment, because they did not bring the man. That was a false witness because they knew who he was and they knew what the scripture had said. Maybe he said, thou shalt not kill. Maybe he said, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's ass, his donkey, his wife, his field, whatever it was. The Ten Commandments, I believe Jesus took and wrote with his finger. Now, I want to share something with you, a contrast right here. Now get this right here now. If we get this right here, we're going to be well on our way to a good understanding. In that Old Testament, in Exodus chapter 20, when Moses took those stones up there to that mount, and he was up there with God for 40 days and 40 nights, and the Bible says that God told them, neither man nor beast come to the mount, that is to that mountain, lest they die because of the holiness of God. But now watch this right here now. Those Ten Commandments, what did God Almighty do with his finger? He took that finger, God took his finger, and he wrote those Ten Commandments in stone. He etched them. And you can just see that. If you could just watch his finger, you could have heard the rock just grinding as he put that in stone. Not to be erased. Not to be overlooked. Not to be ignored. But at the same hand, when Jesus was there to present himself as the Messiah to forgive them, what did Jesus write with his hand? Oh, I'm sure he wrote the Ten Commandments. But he also wrote, for God maybe so loved the world he gave his only begotten Son. Maybe he wrote, but God commendeth his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. As Peter would say in 1 Peter 1:18, that we are redeemed with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. Maybe he wrote on there, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 2, I'm the author and finisher of our salvation. Author and finisher of our salvation, our eternal salvation. Maybe he wrote verses that we know in the New Testament. But you know, he wrote that in sand. And I'm sure as we get down, I'm getting ahead of myself, but I'm sure when he wrote all those commandments, because it said he stooped down twice and wrote in the ground. Maybe the first time he showed that them Ten Commandments in the law. Maybe the next time he showed grace, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Maybe God said, you've not loved me, but I have loved you and ordained you. I paid for you. Remember, one day I'll say on the cross, it is finished. That is salvation. Oh, can you see God on that mountain with the stones there? And that was stones. That God means what he says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. But the same God, the same judge, took his body and placed it on the cross of Calvary and paid our debt in his own blood. You remember, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me go on and I'll mention this in just a minute. The verse 7, and so when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. You know what Jesus is saying? Who made you judge? You're taking my commandments and you're trying to trap me with my own commandments against someone that, yes, is a sinner just like you. Yes, we're all sinners. We're all sinners. The Son of... But now, notice now, Jesus did not say that she was not a sinner. Oh, he condemned her at the end. He said, go and sin no more. So we don't see him compromising the law. We see him giving the grace of the law. We're seeing him right on the ground there. And the Bible says this right here. And he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience. That's the law of God. Let me get the wording there. I want to go to Romans chapter 2. We want to see in verse 15, the clearly scripture says about what the law is and how it applies to you and I. Listen to this scripture. Romans chapter 2, verse 15, which show the work of the law written in their hearts. The Bible says right here, and when they heard it, being convicted of their own conscience, that's the heart, their conscience also bearing witness, their conscience also bearing witness of what Jesus wrote on that ground, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. I got a question for you. Who should have been the first one to walk away when Jesus started giving the commandments? The first one that should have walked away is the one that was calling the very act of adultery. She stayed while those that supposedly are good people and think that they're holier than someone, they're the ones that being convicted by the law of God, and that's what's going to convert a soul, that's what's going to show a person he's lost. Without the Ten Commandments, without the law being showed to that person, they will never get under conviction. But what Jesus was offering them was grace. He was saying, the Ten Commandments is here, but I've come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. But what did they do? They're willing to justify themselves and walk away instead of get right with God. The very first one that should have left was her. She didn't leave. She accepted the grace that was given to her by Jesus. Jesus could have commanded the Ten Commandments to be carried out, and she would have been stoned, and possibly the man too. But no, he came to give grace. He came to fulfill. For God so loved the world. He doesn't want anyone to die. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. The woman should have been the first one to leave. She wasn't the first one to leave. She left. She's standing there in the midst. She never did leave. She said, I accept the grace. I accept, for God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, you, the Messiah. And I believe that. And all the other ones had the opportunity to get saved. Did they get saved? No. It's a possibility some of them got saved later on. But they didn't get saved. They turned away. They turned away. And we go on down through here. And the Bible says when Jesus lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto him, to her, woman, where are those thine accusers? You know what? People need to see that they're going to have to face God first on their sin. You know, Joseph said, how can I do this wickedness and sin against God? David, when he got right with God, he said, I have sinned and sinned in thy sight only and am no longer worthy. He blamed himself. He did not blame Bathsheba. He did not blame Uriah. He did not blame her beauty. He did not blame the duties of him being a king. He said, I have sinned and done this wickedness in thy sight. And the Bible also goes on to tell us in Luke chapter 9. Let me read this. I got it written down. For the Son of Man has not come to destroy man's lives, but to save them. But to save them. And the scripture says, she said, no man, Lord. You know, if you can get along with God and get your sins confessed as a sinner and get saved, when trials and tribulations come along and if somebody does accuse you, you won't fall away. There's many people that fall away because they never gotten born again. This lady stayed there and called Jesus Lord. Who was it else, that one of the disciples that called him Lord? He said, until I see, and until I put my hand in thy side. And Jesus told him, said, come and stick thy hand in my side and believe. And he said, my Lord and my God. That's what she called him, Lord. Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. I want to tell you something of the greatest proof that you have been saved, born again, is that you sin no more. Now, I'm not saying talking about being perfect. You cannot be perfect. I am not referring to perfection. But I am saying when you get saved, there is a change. That woman was no longer going to be a little bit living in adultery. She was a new creature. She accepted the Messiah. She accepted the grace that was given to her by her very God that was standing there. The very God that could have condemned her, and the very God that will condemn if we do not accept that one, the same one, Jesus, which is God, and God is Jesus, we will be condemned. But praise God, hallelujah, I've come to the place to where I've accepted Him as my Messiah, as the Savior of the world. He gave me grace when I saw the law and understood. This lady went home justified. this lady went home saved. She's not the same person she was any longer. If any man be in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new because Christ comes to live within you. Hope you've enjoyed this message. This is a great lesson for us. It is not saying just what 1 week ago I just gave or one of the shorts about judging. We can judge, but we need to rightly to judge and say, yes, we're condemned, but then show the grace of God that God will forgive. And that's rightly dividing the word of truth and the judgment of God. Hope you've enjoyed this lesson, and there's many more to come. And I may do some more shorts, just a minute and a half long or so. I'm kind of enjoying that too. I think I got 3 up so far. So thank you, and return to next time. Thank you. God bless you.